video provides a brief overview of inflammation. Inflammation can be described as a complex and nonspecific response to tissue injury. Acute inflammation provides a vital role in minimizing the effects of injury or infection. An acute inflammation helps remove damaged tissue after resolution of the injury. In addition, acute inflammation helps to generate new tissue and facilitates healing. While acute inflammation is vital to our response to injury or infection, chronic inflammation contributes to the development of chronic diseases, such as cardiovascular disease or cancer. Inflammatory disorders are often ending in itis, such as appendicitis, inflammation of the appendix, tendinitis, inflammation of a tendon, or bronchitis, inflammation of the bronchi. We will start with looking at cells of inflammation. This includes the endothelial cells, platelets, our white blood cells, also known as leukocytes, and while not a cell, we'll look at the extracellular matrix, which plays a vital role in inflammation. The endothelial cells are the single layer of cells that lines the blood vessel. Endothelial cells play multiple roles in the body. And with regard to inflammation, endothelials have an antithrombotic function and they regulate blood flow through regulation of vasodilation and vasoconstriction. Endothelial cells create a selectively permeable barrier to inflammatory stimuli. They also regulate movement of leukocytes, or the white blood cells, from our blood into the tissue in a process called extravasation. Endothelial cells secrete inflammatory mediators, and they regulate immune cell proliferation, meaning that they can regulate the division and increase in numbers of our white blood cells in response to infection or injury. In order for inflammatory products to leave the blood and move into the tissue, endothelial cells need to be able to increase in permeability. Remember that endothelial cells create a tight layer, preventing substances from moving from the blood into the tissue. During inflammation, signals such as those from the platelets will tell the endothelial cells to increase that space within the endothelial layer to allow our white blood cells to squeeze through from the blood into the tissue to attack the site of injury or inflammation, and then to promote healing. You can see here where a white blood cell is squeezing through the endothelial cell into the tissue in that process called extravasation. Our platelets, also known as thrombocytes, are small membrane-bound discs, and their primary function that you think of is during hemostasis, or the clotting process. During inflammation, platelets release inflammatory mediators, so they increase our vascular permeability. So in addition to their clotting function, always remember that platelets mediate our endothelial, or the vascular permeability, during inflammation. The major cellular components of the inflammatory response are the leukocytes, or the white blood cells. The most numerous white blood cells in the blood are neutrophils. Neutrophils are our first responders. They're like the EMTs. They're the first to arrive at the site of inflammation. The main job of a neutrophil is to phagocytize, or eat up, bacteria and cellular debris. They also release enzymes and other antibacterial substances to help prevent further growth and destruction by the microbes. But because these enzymes that are released by neutrophils are so powerful, neutrophils have a short lifespan. We also have leukocytes called eosinophils. They primarily respond when there is a parasitic infection, where they release granules that can kill parasitic worms. And they're also involved in allergic reactions. Two other cells that play a role in allergic reactions are the basophils and the mast cells. Mast cells also play a role in acute and chronic inflammation, primarily at the mucosal surfaces. Mast cells are what hold on to histamine, and in response to a signal, will rapidly release those histamines. And that's what causes you to sneeze and have itchy, watery eyes during an allergic reaction. And you often take a drug like Benadryl, which is an antihistamine. We talked about the neutrophils being the first responders, kind of like the EMTs that arrive at the site of injury. They're only short-lived because they have these powerful enzymes that we don't want to leave in the tissue too long. After the initial response by the neutrophils, our monocytes, which are circulating cells, will squeeze into the tissue and differentiate into a macrophage. A macrophage is another type of phagocytic cell that goes up and eats bacteria and cellular debris. Macrophages can eat more and last longer than the neutrophils, so you might want to think of them as the hospital staff, like the nurses, that then take care of the patient for much longer and help resolve the problem. So to recap a little bit more about inflammation, remember this is an early and immediate reaction of our local tissue and our blood vessels when there's an injury, right? So we talk about cells from the blood will move through the blood vessels and into our tissue. The goal is to remove whatever is injuring the tissue and help to limit damage. And so when you think of inflammation, you're probably picturing these cardinal signs of inflammation. This includes rubor, which is that redness that you get, also known as erythema. Tumor, which is the swelling. Calor, which is the heat you see at the site of inflammation that you feel. And dolor is the pain that often accompanies inflammation. A fifth cardinal sign that was added a little bit later is the loss of function. This doesn't necessarily mean that if you get a splinter in your finger, your whole finger no longer works, but usually at that site of inflammation, you won't be able to use that particular area of tissue. In inflammation, you might hear something called the acute phase response. This is the sum of all systemic manifestations during acute inflammation. So maybe if you just got that splinter in your finger, you might have a localized response. Or maybe if you got infected with a virus that infects your lungs like the flu, that will also send off a system-wide response that causes a full-body response to that injury or infection. Now let's look at the stages of inflammation. There's two major stages of inflammation. The first is the vascular stage. This involves only the blood vessels. During the vascular stage, you're going to see vasodilation, which will increase blood flow to the area, delivering all the equipment needed to help fight this injury or infection. And you're going to have a structural change where you're going to increase that vascular permeability. So this is going to allow proteins and fluid to leave the circulation and enter the tissue. And so you're going to see that redness and that warmth from that vasodilation, and you're going to get that swelling and often the pain from that vascular permeability. You notice I didn't mention any cells here. This is, besides our endothelial cells, this is really just a vascular situation. In the cellular stage of inflammation, this is where we start to involve our white blood cells. So this is the cellular stage. This is where our leukocytes, the first ones are the neutrophils, that move from the blood to the site of injury or infection. So let's look at the vascular phase. Here you have a site of injury at your tissue, and there's going to be changes in the small blood vessels. So often our capillaries and the arterioles. There's going to be a moment of vasoconstriction, And then really you have this rapid vasodilation that increases blood flow to the area. By increasing that capillary flow, you're going to promote that heat and redness because our blood is very warm and it's going to look more red at that site of injury. Also during the vascular phase, you're going to have an increase in permeability. So now you're going to have fluids and proteins are going to leave from the capillaries and move into the tissue. This will cause the remaining cardinal signs of inflammation, which are that swelling from the fluid moving into the tissue, pain both from the pressure from the fluid and sometimes some proteins, that signal pain will be activated, and often loss of function because of that swelling. And then we'll look at the cellular phase. This is where we deliver leukocytes, so first the neutrophils, and then later the macrophages to our site of injury. But for this walkthrough of the four steps, let's just think of them as leukocytes. So you have your leukocytes, they're hanging out in the blood vessels, just merrily rolling along. And then during the cellular phase, the blood is going to slow down. And this allows the neutrophils to creep along the wall of the blood vessel a little more slowly. And they're then going to attach or adhere to the endothelial cells. This is because the endothelial cells have gotten more sticky because of this inflammation. So once you have adhesion and what we call margination, where the blood vessels stick to the leukocytes, then we're gonna have transmigration. This is where that neutrophil is going to squeeze or extravasate through that endothelial lining into the tissue. So first we're rolling along and we gotta slow down and stick. Then we gotta squeeze through during transmigration. The third step is what we call chemotaxis. So now we have this cell squeezes through the lining, but we need to get it to a different part of the tissue. So we leave a chemical trail called chemokines that neutrophil can smell and follow to the site of injury. Much like if you walk into a mall and you're hungry, then you're going to smell the food court and use that smell to find your way to the food. So once we've slowed down and stuck to the cell, then we're going to squeeze through the lining, then we're going to use chemotaxis to find the site of injury. Our final thing in the cellular phase of inflammation is we're going to activate that leukocyte, activate that neutrophil, and then phagocytosis, or engulf the debris or the bacteria to stop this injury. And so you can see here we're going to activate this neutrophil. So it's going to be able to engulf this bacteria here. This process that enhances this phagocytosis is called opsonization. And so you can see here, we've got little molecules attached to the bacteria, very much like a sugar coating that makes it tastier to the white blood cell. And so once this white blood cell is like, ooh, this is tasty, this is my favorite, it's going to eat it, and then it's going to bring it inside and then use its lysosomes and other digestive enzymes to break down this bacteria. And that is our review of inflammation.